Assalamu alaikum, hello and welcome to the Health Show here only on the Islam Channel with me, Alistair Greener. Tackling health problems, every week we're joined by a health expert within their specialised field who discusses the prevention of health issues or concerns that we or our loved ones may face. Looking at how you can change your health and lifestyle for the better, the Health Show offers an alternative viewpoint from our health experts who attend the show. And we really hope that this will help guide you in the right direction. So if you suffer from any medical issues or have any health concerns, or for that matter, if you know anybody who does, then tune in each week as we'll be covering a wide range of topics and offering alternative viewpoints from our health experts. If you'd like any further information on our programme or any of the topics that we discuss, then please do get in touch with us at healthshow@islamchannel.tv. And we'll give that address out again at the end of the show. Now, today we're looking at a campaign launched in August 2019 that supports 15 million people in England who live with long-term health conditions. The campaign, called We Are UNDEFEATABLE, aims to help and support people by using physical activity to get them back on their feet. To discuss the campaign further, it's a real pleasure now to welcome Neil Tester, who's the director of the Richmond Group of Charities, which is a coalition of 14 of the leading health and social care organisations in the voluntary sector. Neil, a very warm welcome.
Hi, Alistair. Thanks for having me on.
It's such an exciting new project. I'm really looking forward to finding out more about it. And research obtained by Sport England suggests that 69% of people living with long-term health conditions would like to be more active. And 66% say it would help manage their condition and improve their sense of well-being. Let's watch the We Are UNDEFEATABLE TV advert.
That's life, that's what all the people say. You're riding high in April, shut down in May. But I know I'm gonna change that tune when I'm back on top in June. I said that's life. And as funny as it may seem, some people get their kicks stomping on a dream. But I don't let it get me down. 'Cause this final world, it keeps spinning around. 'Cause this final world, it keeps spinning around.
So Neil, thanks again for coming on the show. One of the things that strikes me is when you look at that advert, to see so many different conditions on your TV in one advert, that's pretty unusual, isn't it?
It really is. This is a unique campaign that's been put together. And it's great that we've been able to show the experiences of that range of people. Everyone with a health condition to deal with is unique. And I think that the ad brings that alive so wonderfully. And I could watch it all day, every day. It just makes me smile every time I see it.
Well, it is. It's really inspirational. And I can imagine it's going to hit home to a huge amount of people. Let's get back to the real basics. What exactly is it that the campaign's aiming to achieve?
So this campaign's about inspiring people with health conditions to find out more information about how they can get the support that they need and that they tell us that they really want in order to maintain or improve their levels of physical activity. If you have a health condition, and one in four of us do, you are half as likely as someone who doesn't to be physically active enough to prevent further health problems, to get all of the other benefits. And people with health conditions of the kind that you saw in the ad film know about all the benefits. They don't need to be preached at about the need. What they absolutely need is support to be able to do it, and a sense that there are other people out there who found simple, practical, everyday days to improve their activity. And those are some of the people that we're showcasing both in the ad and in some of the amazing films that they've all taken part in.
Do you think that maybe this group of people have felt a little bit isolated before now, until a campaign like this has come along? They felt, actually, where's the support for me?
That's often the case. It's many people with health conditions of the kind that we're talking about will often find it affects their mood. And when that happens, you're quite likely to gradually become more isolated from family and friends. You might not be taking part in the kinds of other social activities that you would have done previously, or if you didn't have the condition. And sometimes, you know, well-meaning family and friends who are generally worried about people's health are scared of people getting out there and taking small steps to activity in case they injure themselves or in case it hurts. And so that can often end up with people unintentionally being quite isolated. So some of the wonderful stories that we've heard through the campaign are as much about people being able to reconnect with their families, their friends, their grandchildren, as they are about the physical activity itself.
And it's interesting, isn't it? So often people, you know, who are aware of somebody with a long-term health condition, you know, they're, much as they might be empathetic, they don't necessarily always understand. So therefore, they don't know how to communicate those things. So where did this all start? Who came up with this brilliant idea of getting all of these charities together, get Sport England involved, and have a, if you like, almost like a communal message? Where did that all start from?
So the campaign itself came out of a whole set of conversations around some practical projects that a number of charities with support from Sport England were already doing to test out different ways of providing support and information, and in some cases to find out more about what people with particular conditions felt would be helpful to them. And out of those projects and the joint working that already started through that scheme came the realisation that some of the biggest barriers were the fact that people didn't know where to go for some support, or that people sometimes felt that when you were talking about physical activity, you were talking about running a 10-kilometre race or a marathon or being in the gym several times a week, when that's really not what we're talking about here. It's about anything from, you know, an older person doing some stretching exercises in their chair, to somebody going for a brisk walk on a day when they feel like it, to some of the things you saw in the film, like the gentleman who goes to a walking football group for men of a certain age. So that's when the really serious conversation started. And I think a great deal of credit is due to Sport England for putting a substantial amount of National Lottery money into helping us to develop this campaign, making sure that we had the time and space to really hear from people with health conditions, whether those were individual conditions or, as is the case for lots of people, more than one condition at once, to understand how people are thinking and feeling about this, what they already know and what they already hear from other places, and what would help them to take action. And it was really from the voices of those people that we realised this campaign needs to be about just inspiring people to take that first step, to accept that some days you're going to have a good day and you can do more, and other days you'll have a bad day and it's okay,
and
because the good days will come again.
You talk about that first step, which is so, so important. And again, as the campaign says, it doesn't have to be a big step, just a step. It's a very new campaign, as you say, you've only been going since August in 2019. So what's the response been like so far, you know, from the general public, you know, in terms of how are they seeing it? What are people with these long-term health conditions, what are they saying about it?
It's been an absolutely phenomenal response, both in terms of people who've seen the TV ads, heard the ads on radio, but also the people that have engaged with the campaign on social media. So this is all, you can find We Are Undefeatable on Facebook, on Twitter, on Instagram. Hashtag is obviously hashtag We Are Undefeatable. One of the really powerful things has been people have seen other people like themselves, or that they can relate to, you know, with a really positive story to tell about the difference that support to be more active has made to them, how it's changed their relationships with their friends and family and their communities, as well as having all of the health benefits that they already knew about, but also just the visibility of some of the conditions. One of the stories that's really hit home to me is that one of the people that's been good enough to let us share their story, a guy called Chris, who has type 1 diabetes and has to inject insulin. And in his film, he's seen injecting before he goes to lead the sporting activity that he volunteers to help other people with type 1 diabetes do. And people online have been saying, well, that's the first time I've seen someone like me injecting in public. If you can do that and people can see it in a video, maybe I can do that when I'm out in a restaurant. So it's a really powerful effect.
It's really interesting that actually we see this more and more, don't we, where the taboo barriers seem to be breaking down, where we see things more, and therefore that helps people relate to other people in that same situation. Because we talked earlier on about people sometimes maybe feeling isolated. And I know one of the things you're doing is actually helping the sport world understand better the whole issue of people with long-term health conditions. Tell us about some of the work you're doing there.
Absolutely. So although the campaign's not about pushing people into sport or sort of organised physical activity, it's about any kind of activity, whether it's walking as far as your garden gate or dancing around the kitchen with your granddaughter. But it, you know, there are people, as you'll have seen from the film, who have found either that they could reconnect with sporting activities that they've enjoyed in the past or undertake new organised activities that they've been introduced to through having the right support. And I think the really important thing about that is that when that works well, it's because the people working in, you know, council leisure centres or gyms or whatever it might be, understand how to provide the right support for people with different health conditions, but also understand that in no way are those conditions a barrier to people being able to take part safely in activity. And a great example of that is that one of the pilot projects I was talking about earlier was undertaken by the Alzheimer's Society, who produced a new information guide for people who work in that field to explain to them the steps they need to take in order to be sure that they're giving the right support and that they're doing it safely and that there won't be any comeback for them. And that's been one of the most popular guides of that sort that the Alzheimer's Society has produced for professionals over a good period of years. So it shows there's a real appetite from people to know how best to support people with health conditions.
And it's great that, you know, you're being very much at the centre of demystifying some of the elements of these long-term conditions that a lot of people, unless you're faced with it with somebody within your family or community, you might not know anything about it. And I like the fact that you're talking about little steps, and it's not just about going down to the gym and doing sort of really rigorous exercise. There's all sorts of things which can almost be part of your hobby. Like one of the things I know you're involved with is Just Dance. Tell us a little bit more about how that works.
One of the marvellous things about the age we're living in is that technology in the home, some of the devices that we often have in our pockets, are giving people new opportunities for things that wouldn't have been the case 20, 30 years ago. So there are lots of games out there where people can, watch on their screen and dance along, or, you know, play tennis. I'm not going to advertise any particular brands of computer game where you hold a wand and wave it, but I think your viewers will know what I mean. I think, you know, it's thinking about the things that people already have available, or that they might, you know a friend who could lend them something to see if they like it. But also, there are lots of amazing community organisations in all of our neighbourhoods up and down the country that will often provide activities, whether it's, you know, a tea dance, or whether it's a guided walk, or anything of that sort
that
doesn't have to be expensive and doesn't have to be difficult to do.
And it has huge benefits, you know, just from the fact of being, you know, the social element as well, getting out with other people and understanding everybody else's conditions. And obviously, people watching this will be thinking, this is fantastic, this is great. I'm maybe one of these people with a long-term health condition, maybe one of my relatives is. How does it actually work in practice? For say somebody hears about the campaign or watches an advert and things, what do they do next?
So yes, if people do see the advert, or if they see any of the information packs that have gone out to GP surgeries and to pharmacies, then the easiest thing to do as a result of that is to go online to weareundefeatable.co.uk, where not only can you watch lots of slightly longer videos about different people with different health conditions who've taken at different stages of life and different social environments, who've done a whole range of different activities that suit them, but also you can link through to websites of the charities involved, where you can find more specific support for people who have a condition like yours, and also often find what's going on in your local area.
So really, really helpful advice. And again, we'll get that website again before the end of the show, so you can write that down, because it's a really valuable resource. As you say, there's lots of things there. And the biggest thing, it must be the impact on the individual, knowing that they're not alone and knowing there's a support structure for them specifically with their specific condition.
Absolutely. It's a really powerful thing. And one of you asked me earlier about how people had responded to the campaign. One of the other really nice things is that I think people have noticed that this is 15 charities coming together in a way that we've rarely seen before. When people see the 15 logos up at the end of the advert, they realise that all of these organisations think this is important enough to work together and do something this substantial about it. And I think that's got to give people a boost to know that, you know, that their individual well-being is important enough for all of these people to come together to help them to undertake the activity that we know they're telling us they would love to do.
It's a big campaign, a huge amount of investment from Sport England, all the charities getting involved as well. How will you be able to tell for yourself that this is actually working, that you're getting results, that people are responding, and that actually this is proving to be a fantastically effective campaign?
So there are all kinds of measurements we're taking about how many people have seen different things and visited and used the resources on the website and all that. But fundamentally, this comes down to, you know, when we keep checking in 6 months' time, in a year's time, in 2 years' time, are more people with health conditions able to undertake the physical activity that they want to do? That's the ultimate test. There's some good news there, actually. The every year there's an annual survey of how active people across the whole of the country are, and that does look also at people with health conditions, and the proportion of people with health conditions getting active has gone up slightly even before the campaign. So we know that we're working with the grain of what people want to do, but ultimately, yeah, it'll be how many people can get the support they need and how many people end up with all of the benefits that they want because we've helped to get the barriers out of the way.
You mentioned earlier on that this is all about people taking that first step, but for many people, especially if they've had all of the worries and stress of developing a long-term health condition, for them, sometimes exercise is the last thing on their mind. They're just coping with whatever the condition is and the change and the impact that that's had on their lives and, for that matter, for the people around them. How do you work with individuals to get them just to take that small little first step, just to get the ball rolling, as it were? Because that's possibly the most challenging moment for people.
Absolutely. And that's where some of the skills that people on the various charities, telephone helplines or online support services come in, because a number of the projects that we're testing out different techniques are exactly trying to do what you're talking about. They're about helping people be reassured that, for example, if you have a condition where you've got chronic pain, or you're often going to have very serious fatigue, how to know, you know, when pain is something that is natural, when it's something that's problematic and should be a sign that you should stop or see somebody. But fundamentally, for example, arthritis, so Versus Arthritis are one of the charities involved in the campaign, for people with arthritis, the activity is actually a way of managing the pain. But unless someone's able to help you understand how to do that well, you're naturally going to be concerned about potentially exacerbating something that you're already having to deal with every day.
I was going to ask that actually about the response from the charities themselves. The fact that, again, in this unique situation, they've all come together collectively to help get people more active and more able. What about the individual elements for each of those charities? They must be getting some tremendous response from people where all of a sudden it's brought these issues of being active more into focus.
Absolutely. And it's really making all of the charities think about, you know, how, where we can go next with this, how we can, you know, most of the charities involved in the campaign also, you know, have people whose job it is to help make sure that people who make policy that influences our lives and who run local and national services really understand what matters to people with either individual conditions or a number of health conditions. And this is already influencing plans for what they do individually and what we all do together next. So it's a really, really exciting time.
Well, we've just really sort of touched the tip of the iceberg here in terms of how effective and how big this project is and the campaign. And it's been great to hear the stories and to hear the impact that it's having on people. We've got lots more to come in the second half. So for the moment, thank you very much indeed. But we must now stress, though, that should you suffer from any medical problems or health concerns, it's always highly recommended that you contact your doctor or GP, as the Health Show gives you an alternative viewpoint to the health concern being discussed. We've got lots more to talk about, so join us after the break. Don't go away. Hello and welcome back to the Health Show, where today we're looking at the UNDEFEATABLE campaign. In this part of the show, I'm pleased to welcome Simone Gomez, who says physical activity and positivity has massively helped her through her recovery from both a stroke and a heart transplant. Simone had to learn how to move and walk again, which was incredibly tough. However, finding things to do, and in her words, just getting on with it, has helped her to become more active and enjoy it. Before we talk to her more, let's take a look at her story.
I don't know what's going to happen. None of us know what's going to happen. I mean, I didn't expect to have a transplant when I was 27. I was born with a congenital heart defect, so that means I had one pumping chamber that worked and only three valves instead of four. So that led up to me having a stroke when I was 19. I put on a poker face, so I could have a really bad day. When I go out, no one will ever know. But, you know, behind closed doors, yeah, I have my little problems, you know. It's normal everyday stuff, like obviously when you're cleaning, making a cup of tea, those little things that I think everyone, we kind of take for granted, just the little things that we can do, which, you know, obviously I did until I had my stroke. So, yeah. My doctor, he said that I should walk 2 miles every day. I don't walk 2 miles every day. I'm not gonna don't do it every day. But, you know, I try to, like, my partner and I will walk like, to the Horniman Museum near me, which is, well, for me, I'd say it's like 20 minutes, half an hour away, because my legs are small. For my partner, it's probably like 5 minutes. So, and that, you know, walking up that hill, it can be very strenuous, so I have to take a break because I'll be out of breath, my legs start hurting, and then I'll go again. We play, I think it's called Just Dance. That's really good. I'm really good at it. I'm really good. I get, like, high scores. Better than my partner, so, but yeah. So, it's fun. It's fun, even though I am tired, I'm out of breath, it's fun. So, and you know, we're both enjoying, and it's someone doing something with me. I'm not doing it by myself. You will have your down days, and you have to kind of accept that. It's difficult to accept it, but you will accept it. But just to kind of, you know, just keep pushing and set goals for yourself. It doesn't have to be huge goals, it can be very small. But set goals for yourself and just strive for that and be positive, smile through it. Think, you know, like, I kind of think when I do have my down days, I start thinking about my donor's family because they lost somebody. So, I mean, that could have been me. So just be grateful the fact that you're alive and that you're here and you're a survivor, you know?
First of all, Simone, thank you so much indeed for coming on the show and also for sharing your remarkable story as well. I'd like to go back to the beginning a little bit and get a bit of a background about you and your condition that led up to what we saw on the VT there.
Okay, thank you for having me. So I was born with a congenital heart defect. So that caused me to have 3 valves instead of 4. And only one of my pumping chambers were working. So, you know, the blood flow and the oxygen levels wasn't great. My oxygen level was really low, probably about 85%, which was normal for me. But for a normal person, you know, that's really bad. So over the years, I've had numerous operations and procedures done. So this led to me having a stroke at 19, which obviously for any 19-year-old would be a shock. I didn't realise it was actually a stroke. I didn't think a 19-year-old could have a stroke. You know, people do say, you know, with strokes, old people. So I do remember when I had my stroke, my mum was actually at work that night. She used to be a nurse and she was actually working on the stroke ward, which was really weird. And my partner at the time, he came to my home and within 15 minutes later, I had a stroke. Obviously, we didn't know it was a stroke. Called the ambulance, paramedics came. And yeah, I remember being rushed to hospital. And that was it. I woke up and I couldn't walk. I couldn't talk. And I love talking. So that was pretty bad. But I couldn't talk. I couldn't do anything myself. So that was pretty devastating. You know, something so small, which obviously is now massive to me because I can't do it myself, has been taken away from me. My mum and my dad, they really helped my recovery. And like, I mean, they're great. So I had intensive physio. I was in hospital for 3 months, intensive physio every day. I probably missed one physio session. I'd done speech therapy and I mean, everyone was fantastic at the hospital. When it came to me going home, I had outpatients, physiotherapy. I had to have a carer. She didn't last for long. My mum got rid of her. But yeah, I remember going into a depression. Yeah, I felt like I was going into like a dark hole. I didn't really know.
Well, we talked a little bit about that before, didn't we? And at your age, particularly knowing how unusual this situation was, that must have been quite isolating for you.
Yeah, it was. I remember being in my room one night and I was talking to a friend and all of a sudden I started crying. I was like in hysterics, just crying. I couldn't breathe. My head felt like it was about to explode. And he said to me, you need to go and talk to your mum. I was like, I don't know what to say. I can't speak. Like, I felt like I literally just could not speak. Ended up going to my mum's room. Didn't say a word. I just broke down. She called my dad and said, something's wrong with Simone. Like, she needs help. So I remember my mum the next day calling a counsellor. We went to a private counsellor. She wasn't good. She basically just told me what I told her. It's like, you know, you're telling me what I already know. So that didn't help, but my parents did help a lot. And my family, I mean, friendships. I mean, I have friends, but because they don't understand my health problems, and to be honest, I don't expect them to understand. So I find that I'm quite isolated when it comes to friends. I mean, I do still keep in touch with friends, but going out, partying, that's not what I do anyway. So yeah, my family's been such a support.
And it's really interesting what you're going through, although it was, you know, extraordinary to be going through that at a very young age. You obviously must hear these stories all the time, and to be able to bring people together and to be able to facilitate, if you like, a sharing of knowledge must be actually really beneficial for all of those individuals. And you know, you see this all the time, right?
Oh, absolutely. There are millions of people every year who are in contact with the 15 charities involved in the campaign because they need exactly the kind of advice and support that Simone needed, and also need to hear that they're not alone and that there are other people going through similar things. Everyone's experience is unique, and there's, you know, it's really important that people don't try to give exactly the same kind of support to everybody just because they think they've put a label on a particular condition, but nonetheless to know that there are other people there who've benefited from the kind of support that those charities can bring. And that's a really big part of what we're trying to do with the movement that we're trying to build with this campaign as well, for people to feel like they're part of something. And we hope that people who've been helped by getting support from hearing the campaign messages, getting in touch, getting information and support, will in turn be able to spread the word to other people that they know.
One of the things we talked about before was this sense of community that's clearly evolving as a result of that campaign. Clearly, you're the face of the campaign in many respects because you're out there, you know, we're seeing you, we're hearing about your story. What impact has that made on you?
Oh, wow. Well, doing this campaign, I've just enjoyed meeting different people because I usually meet people who've had strokes. So I'm with the Stroke Association. So I do some stuff with them. So I meet a lot of stroke survivors. But doing We Are Undefeatable, I've met different people with different health problems who are fantastic. They're great. And I feel really proud to be a part of it and honoured to have been chosen as well, like the chosen one.
Let's come back to what the campaign is about, which is effectively getting people to be mobile, to get them doing one step at a time, to build up to being more active. How did you start? You were going through that intense physiotherapy. Yeah. How did that tie into what you learned with We Are Undefeatable?
So I think with my heart transplant, like I said on the video, my doctor did say I need to walk 2 miles a day, which I don't, because some days I don't want to get out of bed some days. So, but I do try and push myself, and my partner pushes me quite a lot as well. He's really good. And my parents are motivating me as well, even though they're like, don't do too much, let's take it easy. I do remember going to the gym. So I'm still getting used to my body, knowing what's going on. Going to the gym, I told the personal trainer, because at the time I actually wanted a friend to come with me, but they didn't want to. So I needed to get a personal trainer because I was so anxious to go by myself with these big people in the gym. And I'm small and I'm like, oh gosh, what am I doing? So I let my personal trainer know, look, I've had a heart transplant and I've had a stroke. So, you know, can you set out a program for me, something? Which he kind of did, but it was kind of, because he's never dealt with someone with a health problem, he didn't really know what to do. So he was getting me doing weights and all sorts. I'm like, I am out of breath. My chest is hurting me. Like, this, something's not right.
And it's really interesting you highlight that, because we were talking about that in the first half, about the education of people within the sporting fraternity to help them understand different people with different conditions. So how do you go about that, Neil? How do you go about, when there's such a broad spectrum of conditions that we're looking at, to try and help this sports community understand the sort of things that they might encounter as a result of the campaign?
So the way we're doing that through the campaign is to work with and involve the huge number of organisations there are that people who are, you know, sport or exercise professionals are members of, their own sort of professional organisations, trade bodies for, you know, people who run any kind of establishment where you can do physical activity. I mean, that's where Sport England's involvement in the campaign has been really helpful, because they have established relationships with lots of those. On the same website where people with health conditions can find support, other people who want to get involved and want to provide the right support to help people get active can also find more information and advice, can sign up as organisational supporters, and also get more materials to help to spread the word so that people understand that if they go to their service or take part in their activity, they're going to be met with the kind of support that they need.
We're going to repeat again at the end of the show how people can get more information, where they can go, the website, the social media, and so on. And social media is a big element of this. I know you've touched on this earlier on, Simone. You know, being, you know, of your age group, that's something you're very in tune with.
Yeah.
What sort of messaging messaging, what kind of help and support are you getting as a result of being on social media? How's that community helping?
I'm big on Instagram. I love Instagram. Being in the Undefeatable campaign, having a lot of comments, positive comments as well, saying, well done, Simone. I've got this health problem, or my partner's got this health problem, and watching your video has helped us. It gives me a bit of a buzz that I can actually give something back as well. It's not much that I'm doing. I'm just sharing my story. But if sharing my story can help somebody else, that's huge to me.
And what about relating to people who aren't in your age group? Maybe people who are older, who have maybe a completely different set of conditions, but somehow you're now interacting with them. That must be quite amazing to broaden your horizons into what else is out there.
Oh, yes, because my dad, he's got Parkinson's disease. So it actually does help me to speak to other people, different age range, about different health problems as well. And it helps me to actually know how to deal with my dad's health problem. So it is good that I'm kind of out there talking to different people, age groups. And yeah, it's just positive. It's so positive.
And it's interesting you say positive, because it is a mindset, isn't it? It is about getting someone to be in that frame of mind where, as you say, it's not every day, but generally feeling positive. How do you help with the campaign, Nick, to help people overcome that, possibly an emotional barrier of being positive, seeing something positive out of what is for most people a very negative experience?
Well, I think the most powerful way that the campaign is doing that is through the stories that people like Simone, who generously agreed to put their lives out there for other people to hear about, are providing. Because I think pretty much everybody involved says the same sort of thing that Simone said in her film, that, you know, there are going to be days when you can't walk your 2 miles. There are going to be days when you people have other problems in life as well, regardless of their health. And there'll be times when anybody would find it harder to be physically active. But seeing that other people have gone through that and are able to pick it back up again when they do feel up to it and can sort of get back on the course that they've set for themselves. We all kind of watch and learn by example, and we take courage in what other people have been able to do. And that's why those personal examples are at the heart of the power of the campaign.
And we know that mental health and physical health are so interconnected these days, and there's a lot of talk about the mental health campaigns and things to help people overcome that. But just getting physical must do a tremendous amount for you, Simone, just to getting you out and about, freshening your mind effectively. Give us an idea of how it does affect your mental health, just being that little bit more physical than maybe you might not have been without the campaign.
So, like I said, I've struggled with depression, and I still struggle with a little bit and anxiety. So when I do, a little bit of exercise, it does actually make me feel good, especially if I'm doing it with somebody like my partner, like the Less Dance. You're having fun with it, you're exercising, you're sweating. So no, it does make me feel really good. And also, because I find a lot of people have invisible illnesses, so I think this is of such a good campaign to highlight that as well. Because people see me, I would never know I've had a heart transplant or a stroke. I smile a lot, but they wouldn't know behind closed doors. I have really bad days. And you would never know.
It's one of those things, isn't it, which I think society is generally getting better at not assuming things about people, but we've still got a long, long way to go when it comes to that. Neil, you see people in all sorts of different environments. One of the things I really want to touch on here a little bit is about people who know people. So like Simone's partner, who's been obviously a tremendous help all the way through her recovery. What would you say to somebody who's watching, who has a partner or has someone close to them who has a long-term condition, to help them to not just come to terms with what they have, but to get them making those first steps?
So I think I would say that I hope that people's partners, other family members, friends will reflect on the things that the 12 people in our films are saying about their experience of those relationships, and understand that actually they, rather than trying to wrap people in cotton wool with really good intentions, but that can sometimes not be the right thing for the person, that it's really important to listen to what the person that you love or you are friends with wants and needs, and what their own goals and ambitions are, and work with that, because actually both people in that partnership want the person to be able to make some progress and to you know, have more good days than bad days, but doing that together rather than putting protective barriers in people's way or pushing people to go too far too fast is what's really important.
And having that community that you've been very much a part of course, is almost as much as important for your partner as it is for you. The fact that he feels there's actually a community of people out there who are supporting people like you.
And that's the thing I think is important, even, like, you know, your partner or any family members that have that support as well. For example, like when I had my stroke, I didn't think my parents had that much support, which was a bit of... It made me feel quite bad because, you know, they had to take me on, which was a lot. So I do think it's important as well for your partner or family members to have that support as well. And then when they do see, like you said, with the We Are Undefeatable campaign, it's like a community and they're seeing other people's support. It's like they feel good in themselves and they learn as well.
Now, although you are clearly an incredibly articulate spokesperson, you're doing an amazing job spreading the positive word. Let's come back to you personally. What has Undefeatable meant to you during the whole campaign since it launched to right now?
Oh, wow. It's meant a lot. It has brought back a lot of memories from stroke, emotional, but I'm very proud. You know, I'm very proud to be a part of it. And, you know, to be able to even be on this show today and to be a, I don't know, I'm trying to get the word, to, like, be a, I guess I said, a spokesperson for the campaign.
Yeah.
And to, like, I'm really actually proud of the campaign. I'm really proud of it. I remember seeing it first on TV. I think it was nighttime. Yeah, it was nighttime, ITV. And I was so excited. I actually started crying. I was like, oh, my gosh. And, like, everyone has done amazing. And I'm proud of everyone, actually, who's been in it.
And you should be proud. You've done an incredible thing by not just sharing your story, but just being out there and being such an inspiration to other people. And I think what we need to end up on, again, is to make sure that people are aware of this message. It's a very, very new campaign. And we're proud to be a part of helping to make people aware of the campaign. So, again, Nick, tell us, if somebody's watching, they've been inspired by hearing Simone's story, they've been inspired by what they've heard, what can they do next?
So they can, hopefully they'll be able to find more information on their access in their GP practice or in their local pharmacy. But the easiest, quickest thing to do is to go online to weareundefeatable.co.uk or on any of the social media platforms. The accounts are always We Are Undefeatable and it's hashtag We Are Undefeatable.
We like a hashtag. Very good. So for people, again, maybe Simone, you've been there where you haven't always asked for help. Maybe you think, you know, you try and brave it out yourself. You don't want to be burnt to other people, all those kind of things. What would you say to somebody who's thinking, shall I really look at that? Shall I not look at it? What would you say to encourage someone just to click on the website, look up the hashtag to get more information?
That click on it, I'm on there. especially with young people, and it sounds so bad just with young people, but I would encourage them to, like, no, don't be alone, don't stay alone, talk to somebody and go on the We Are Undefeatable.
Just get onto it.
get onto it, because there's so many great stories.
Yeah.
And they'll find
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
It's been absolutely brilliant for both of you. Thank you very much indeed for coming on the show. We really, really do appreciate it. But unfortunately, that's all we have time for today. I'd like to thank our guests again for coming on the programme. Neil Tester, who's the director from the Richmond Group of Charities. And of course, Simone Gomez, who's shared her amazing story. Thank you very much indeed. Once again, we must stress that should you suffer from any medical problems or health concerns, it's always highly likely and highly recommended recommended that you contact your doctor or GP, as the health show gives you an alternative viewpoint to health concern being discussed. If you'd like any more information on this or any of the subjects we've discussed on the show or during the series, please email us at healthshow@islamchannel.tv. That's healthshow@islamchannel.tv. Join us again next week. Goodbye for now. Assalamu alaikum.